Good evening, everyone. You're all very welcome. I'd like to start our service by standing and singing this lovely hymn. My soul in sad exile was out in life's sea, so burned with sin and distressed. Could we stand as we sing? My soul in sad exile was out on life's sea, so burdened with sin and distress, till I heard a sweet voice saying, make me your choice, and I entered the haven of rest. I found my soul in the haven of rest. Yeah.
marvelous that he brought us in, eh? Where we were and where we are today. Praise God. What a change in my life has been wrought. We're going to bow our heads and we're going to remember those that are sick tonight and pray for them that God will visit them wherever they are. We pray for Darren McElveen and Wesley and June Bellingham and Christina, and pray for Raymond and Margaret Wright, David Loudon, and we pray for Sammy Orr and Edna Scott and Beatrice McGarry, Patsy Doherty, and we pray for Alec Robinson, Dave Borland and Sam Bloomfield. Sam's out of hospital. And we pray for Elizabeth McAreevy, Peter Moy, and Joanne Peden. And we do pray for Philip Archibald, too, and his family. Ray Laverty, too. And we pray for Johnny McCurdy and Gwenny Stewart and Robert Gilmore. We pray for the 14-year-old boy who's got cancer. He's going over to England, I understand, for further treatment. And we do pray for this young lad. We pray for Paul and Hazel and Jean Scott, Martin and Liz Moore, Alison McClellan too, and Bobby Todd. He's out of hospital as well. And Bobby Archibald, Joan Hunter. And we pray for Ellen Morris too, and Robert Hunter. Liz Henry is going in for surgery next Thursday, or this Thursday coming. And we just pray very much for Liz, that God will be with her and undertake for her and grant that the surgery will indeed go well. Esther Deveny hasn't been out with us today. She's unwell. And we do pray for Esther that the Lord will be with her. Philip Doak needs the Lord. And we pray for Gillian's mother. She's starting radiotherapy before Christmas. And we do pray that God will undertake for her there. Victor Creelman too. And Don Logan needs the Lord very much. And we pray for Martin McGarry and Tommy McCracken and Stuart Boyd. Ruth McAleese is in Dalrymple Hospital. And we do pray very much for Ruth, that God will touch her and heal her. We pray for Pastor Dempster too, and my sister-in-law is at home now and after all these weeks, and we just praise the Lord for her recovery. We do pray for God's servants as they minister the word of God and minister in song. We just pray that God will indeed anoint in a mighty, mighty way in the lovely name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, here are many, many needs, and God is well able to undertake for each and every one of them. Sister Eleanor Coulter, Eleanor, would you bring us before the Lord tonight and pray that God will just bless our time together? Jesus, yeah. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. We're delighted to see you all this evening. And we do give you a very warm welcome in the lovely name of our Lord Jesus. We just don't have as many out tonight as we had on Friday night. It would be lovely. So someone has suggested that we maybe have dinner on a Sunday night and then have the service afterwards. Maybe that would be encourage people to go out. We had a great night on Friday night, as I said this morning. We appreciate Trevor and all the work that he put into it. And we enjoyed the meal, and the service was just outstanding, and we do appreciate the fellowship that we had together, indeed. If you'd like a CD of any of our services, you can have that by putting your name down on the sheet at the back, and also the 50p box is there if you'd like to contribute to that. The newsletter, this month's newsletter, is at hand if you'd like a copy of that, or some calendars there if you'd like to pick some up as you leave the church. They're free, and you can give them out to your friends. There's lovely scripture texts on them, and who knows, it could be a blessing to someone. Looking forward to Wednesday at 8 o'clock as our prayer meeting. We're looking forward to another great time round the throne of grace in prayer. Come along, join with us at 8 o'clock on Wednesday evening. Then Sunday morning at 11:30 is our breaking of bread service and Sunday school. And then Sunday evening at 6:30 is our evangelistic service, and I will be the speaker at both those services. Let's pray that God will move in a mighty, mighty way. Delighted to have Brother Hugh and Sister Barbara with us. I'm sure you thought maybe when we were mentioning that Hugh was going to sing. He's not, but his wife is. And Barbara's going to sing a couple of pieces. And then we're going to have Hugh coming to minister God's word.
Into the tent where a gypsy boy lay dying. Well, good evening. I suppose it's my turn now. But I'd like to thank the pastor and the deacons for inviting me to take part in the service tonight, which I am really thankful for. Now, tonight, we're reading in the book of Acts in chapter 16. Usually when you mention the book of Acts and the chapter 16, you usually think about the story of the Philippian jailer. Well, we're going to look at the Philippian jailer, but not only the Philippian jailer. If you read the book of Acts, which, as you know, was written by Dr. Luke, it's a thrilling, thrilling story of how God started the early church, the gospel church, as we would say, after the death and resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And we want to look at a small snippet of that tonight. There's four pieces we want to look at. Don't panic, I'll not keep you that long. But as we look at this here, I'll fill you in the background before we read it. Paul here was, he had moved from some other situations, and he got a call one night while he was sleeping, and it was from a man in Macedonia to come over to Macedonia and to the region of Philippi, etc. And it's when Paul comes along here, we want to break into the story tonight. And we're reading chapter 16 from verse 14. Chapter 16, reading from verse 14. Now, a certain woman named Lydia heard us. She was a seller of purple from the city of Thyatira, excuse my pronunciation, who worshipped God. The Lord opened her heart to heed the things spoken by Paul. And when she and her household were baptized, she begged us, saying, "If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come to my house and stay." So she persuaded us. Now it happened, as he went to prayer, that a certain slave girl, possessed with a spirit of depression, met us, who brought her master much profit by fortune telling. This girl followed Paul and us and cried out, saying, "These men are the servants of the Most High God, who proclaim to us the way of salvation." And this she did for many days. But Paul, greatly annoyed, turned and said to the Spirit, "I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her." And he came out that very hour. But when her master saw that their hope of profit was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace to the authorities. And they brought them to the magistrates and said, "These men, being Jews, exceedingly trouble our city, and they teach customs which are not lawful for us, being Romans, to receive or observe." Then the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrate tore off their clothes and commanded them to be beaten with rods. And when they had laid many stripes on them, they threw them into prison, commanding the jailer to keep them securely. Having received such a charge, he put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks. And we'll end our reading there. We could read on, but we'll talk about it because for the sake of time. As I said there, this story here is a thrilling story of how the early church began. This here, as we read up in Acts 16, is Paul's second missionary journey. It's while Paul was sleeping that God speaks to him and tells him to go to this Macedonia and to go to Philippi. As we look at this story here, we see here that God had plans in order. It's a bit like a jigsaw. There was little snippets, but God had it all on plan. Sometimes there in our lives, things happen and we don't know why they happened. Paul had been going to a couple of other places, but God stopped him. And then all of a sudden, he's told to go to Macedonia. And there, when he goes, where's the first place Paul wants to go? It's to worship God. And there he meets this lady called Lydia. Now, we can learn some very important lessons from this lady called Lydia. We read here that she was a fairly well-to-do person. She was getting on well in life. She was a seller of purple. Purple was a very, very important thing in that city. And the dye was used to make many cloths. We see also about her, she was a church goer. She was a church goer. She was, as we would say, a pillar of the community. She was the sort of person you'd want to be. But yes, when Paul came along, Paul came to go along to wherever there was a meeting on. Now, the situation was this, that they didn't, see if I get my notes up. Technology is a wonderful thing. When it works, when it doesn't work, then you're involved. It's all right now. But as I say, Paul wanted to go to wherever the church was meeting. There was no meeting there at that time, so they had to meet at the riverside. And Paul arrived. As it says there, on the Sabbath day, we went out of the city to the riverside where prayer was customarily made. It says here, I read these, the fact that the Jews of Philippi had no synagogue and met by the river means that they had not many Jewish men in Philippi. In other words, the ladies weren't allowed to start a church. It had to be the men. So this is why the ladies met at the riverside, because they would be down there for another reason, be down there to do their washing. So Paul came down when they heard that the prayer meeting was down at the riverside. And as the setup was, because they heard Paul and Silas was coming along, they allowed them to speak. And when Paul spoke, Paul told the wonderful story of saving grace, of how the Lord Jesus had died on the cross and had rose again. And anyone who trusted in him could be saved. Guess who the first convert was, as we read it there? It was Lydia. Imagine that, a church goer, but still she wasn't saved. Isn't that like many today? They are seen as good people. You couldn't say one thing wrong about them. But they're still on that downward road. They're not saved. You know, there are many today like that. I can testify, without going into details tonight, that was me as well. I was a churchgoer. I was found in church every Sunday. But yet I discovered one thing. There had to become a time in my life when I asked Jesus to take away my sins and to cleanse me from all on sin. It didn't mean because I sat in a certain pew or I paid so much into the church or I'd done this, that, and the other. The Word of God says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And it's only when we come and trust Jesus as Savior that we can be sure of our place in heaven. And so that was the next problem solved for Paul and Silas, because we read about it. It says there, when Paul and Silas came to Philippi, they didn't have anywhere to stay. They had no food. They had no nothing. God spoke to them and told them to go there. And what do we read of? When this woman got saved, read it there at the end of verse 15. And when she and her household, not only her, but her whole house got saved, her whole family, were baptized, she begged us, saying, if you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come in my house and stay. So she persuaded us. So there's their physical needs met as well. God supplied all of their need. The second person in this, or the second person we want to look at in this story tonight, is this little girl. This little girl was, we read of here, possessed with a devil. Now those who took charge of her used her, to use up-to-date modern language, for fortune telling. And that's how they made their living, was through this girl doing this. But what do we read of us? When she saw Paul and Silas, she started shouting, as we can see here, that here, these men come from a very high God, and they're telling the message of salvation. And it says this girl followed Paul and us and cried out, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God who proclaim to us the way of salvation. Now that's a strange statement for someone who is possessed with a devil to proclaim. No, it's not, because the devil, as well as you and me, knows the way of salvation. He may not have it, but he knows the way of salvation because he's a fallen angel. So therefore, he will try every trick possible to keep you and me from doing two or three things. Firstly, from reading God's word, from praying, and if you're not already, from getting saved. You know, he knew the way of salvation as well. But Paul knew that this little girl advertisement for him wasn't genuine, so he didn't want it. So as we read of it there, it says that he commanded the devil to come out of her. You'll notice something else that Luke emphasizes as well. It says that the devil, when Paul spoke in the name of the Lord Jesus and said to her, that the devil come out of her immediately. You see how Luke emphasizes that for a purpose. You see, some people say, oh, sure, if you pray in this meeting tonight and then next week or next month, you'll maybe get saved. Not at all. The Word of God tells us if we humbly bow this very minute, as the old hymn says, this moment from Jesus our pardon receives, and we too belong to him. And so it was, as quickly going down the story, when this girl lost her power, her masters were far, far from being happy. And so we read of in our story tonight that they threw Paul and Silas, caught them, and take them to the magistrates. And then we come into that famous story, the story of the Philippian jailer, which many, many learned men, far learned than me, have preached on. And it says that they took them to the magistrate and beat them. Now, they believed at that time that Paul and Silas were Jews and not Romans, so there was a different law. You could beat a Jew more than what you could beat a Roman. And so it was, we read of there, that it says that they beat them with stripes until their back was really in raw flesh, we might say. And we read of there that they were through into prison. Now, so they were thrown into prison, into a dark dungeon, and their backs are in raw flesh, but it also tells us that they put their legs in stocks. You know, you've maybe seen pictures of this, and they put them into the wooden stocks so they couldn't move their legs. But these were special ones. If you read of, it says that there were two holes on them. Now, if you ever watched any ballet dancing or that on TV, you'll see that they can stretch their legs right out. And this is what they done with Paul and Silas. The stocks weren't like that, the two legs together, but their legs were stretched as far as they could. So it was real, real agony. Not only the backs and raw flesh, but their legs. And we know the rest of the story. If you or I had been in such a situation as that, it'd been very easy to complain. It'd been very easy to say, oh, how did I ever get into a mess like this? But what do we read of? We didn't take time to read it, but what does it say? But at midnight, Paul and Silas weren't sleeping. They weren't complaining. It says they were praying and singing hymns to God, and the rest of the prisoners heard them. They couldn't believe it. Here's these two men, and we saw the beating they got and everything that happened to them. Yes, their physical bodies may not be in good shape, but that doesn't hurt their heart. And they sing praises unto God. And you know they were praying, and you know God answers prayer. Maybe not always the way we want it, but God answers prayer. But God answered prayer in a miraculous way that night, because the next thing we hear of, and this is something you maybe didn't look in details, an earthquake came and opened the prison cell doors, and all their chains fell off. Every chain fell off. I brought a, I'm not going to read it all, but read you a wee bit of a hymn, just one of the great hymns that we sing, and it says this, long my imprisoned spirit lay fast bound in sin and nature's night, thine eye diffused a quickening ray, I woke, the dungeon flamed with light, my chains fell off, my heart was free, I rose, went forth, and followed thee. And that night, God came in, and the earthquake came. But here's the miracles. Watch for these miracles. The prison doors all opened. The chains fell off all the prisoners. But nobody escaped. Isn't that a miracle? Nobody escaped because Paul heard the guard, this Philippian guard who had been entrusted with this for his life, that he would guard these prisoners. He took out his sword and he was ready to kill himself when Paul, as we know the story so well, Paul shouted with a loud voice, do yourself no harm. We're all here. Miracle number one. We're all here. And it says that the keeper of the prison got a light and came in to Paul and Silas' cell. That was complete darkness. He brought a light in. And here we see such a change in a man. Beforehand, he had been one of them who had been part of the party who had whipped them and left their back in raw flesh and in the stocks. And then what does he say? He calls them, sir. Luke's very careful to use the language right. Sirs, what must I do to be saved? Boys, wish to God that more people would be crying out of that cry, Lord, what must I do to be saved? You know, this sort of thing only happens when God's people get on their knees praying. You know, there are many tonight and they have no time for the prayer meeting. I can't understand that. I'm far from being perfect by any means. But the child of God who has no time for the prayer meeting, there's something wrong with her Christian life. And so this man came in. The other thing about it is this. Luke never gives him a name. He's just called the Philippian jailer. He's never given a title of any kind. But the very fact that night, as he fell on his knees in that cold prison, and there's Paul and Silas and them stocks, and what do they say to him? You know it far better than me. They don't say to him, oh, here, but I'll tell you a wee story. You're a Roman. We're different. Here, you don't need to start and attend church or amend your ways and do this and do that. Here, do you belong anywhere? Do you belong to the temple? Have you paid in well to the temple? No. What does Paul say? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. Amen. You know, no denomination, no nothing. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. Here's another miracle. Not one of the prisoners escaped. They were all there. And the other thing about it is this. If you've ever watched on TV or that there, an earthquake in a country, you see all the buildings desolated and all, every shape. But yet, in this earthquake, it's only the doors opened. It's only their chains that come off. The building didn't crumble around them. And then we see another change in the Philippian jailer. He says, come on, I'll take you home and bind up your wounds. And so Paul and Silas come out of the prison. But that's the other miracle which you have to read into to see is this. When they went out onto the street, if there had been an earthquake, the whole street would have been in chaos. Everybody would have been running here, there, and yonder, looking for safety and maybe looking for other relatives who were caught in the earthquake. But there's no talk about that. And the Philippian jailer takes him to his home, and there's no problems there. The house is still standing. And when they take him to the house, what's the first thing Paul does? He starts preaching the message of the gospel to his family. And what do we read of in scripture? We didn't read it. It says that all of the household of the Philippian jailer got saved. Verse 34, it says this. Now when he had brought them into his house, he set food before them, and he rejoiced, having received God with all his household, his whole family, his servants, everybody has got saved. An earthquake with a difference. But that was Paul and Silas' opportunity. We're out of prison now. For all we know, tomorrow morning they could be ready to behead us. But what do we read of? We read that Paul and Silas and the Philippian jailer, they went back to prison. They went back to the prison. Why? Because if they hadn't went back, the jailer would have been executed. So they showed love to him, irrespective about how they felt themselves. But not only that, here was another miracle when they went back. All the prisoners were still there. There wasn't one person had escaped. It was a miracle and an earthquake for a reason, to save this man, the Philippian jailer, and his household. You know, Paul had taken the message that God wanted him to go there. The vision, go to Macedonia. He didn't know what was happening. He didn't know whether he's going to get his nights, where he's going to stay, or whether he's going to get any food. But he relied on God completely. And here we see there's Lydia saved. And then he had to endure beatings. He had to go to prison. All so that the Philippian jailer could get saved. You know, some people think when they get saved that it's all a bed of roses. When we get saved, that's the start. We may have to stand up for the Lord Jesus. And it may cost us, but one day God's word has told us there's a great trophy for us in heaven. My, that's going to be someday when we go to heaven. And when they went back to prison, guess what? The magistrates didn't want to know them when they heard they were Romans. They couldn't wait to get them out of the prison. They couldn't wait to get them out of the prison and out of their authorities. And yet, that was all in God's wondrous plan. I'd like to finish with reading the words of an old hymn. Unlike MD Elts, I can't sing it, so I'll have to just read you the words. Wonderful love that rescued me, sunk deep in sin, guilty and vile as I could be, no hope within. When every ray of light had fled, O glorious day, raise my soul from out the dead. Love found a way. And the chorus says, love found a way to redeem my soul. Love found a way that could make me whole. Love sent my Lord to the cross of shame. Love found a way. Oh, praise his holy name. Yes, it was love that saved us. It's love, the love of the Lord Jesus for you and me. I wonder tonight, is there one in their gathering, or one maybe watching on YouTube, and as yet you haven't trusted Christ as your Savior? Could I strongly recommend him? I pray that God would use this short, stammering thoughts of mine to bring honor and glory to his mighty name. To his be the glory. Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you, Hugh. That was a lovely word. Praise God. What a change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy over my soul like the sea billows roll since Jesus came into my heart. What a wonderful day that was. Praise his lovely name. Thank you, brother. And thank you, Barbara, for those two beautiful pieces as well. Let's pray. Our gracious God and eternal Father in heaven, in the lovely name of our Lord Jesus, we bow before thee at the end of this beautiful service. And Father, we thank you for your precious word that our brother has brought to us. And Father, we just pray indeed that thy word will go deep into every heart and every life in this gathering today. And oh Father, we pray above all things that some soul or souls will come to know Jesus as their Savior and Lord and Master. Father, we just praise you for Hugh, and we ask you, Lord, that you will just continue to bless him and to use him for the glory of God in the vineyard that you have set him in. And Father, grant that, O God, through his ministry, that many precious souls will come to know Jesus as Savior and Lord and Master. Father, will you bless every head bowed in your presence? Undertake for every need that we may have, Lord. And Father, we praise you for everything that you have done for us. We give you thanks in the lovely name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. We're going to sing a closing hymn together. There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar as the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. We're going to stand as we sing this lovely hymn. There's a land that is fair.